So last time we discussed the construction of a non-deterministic finite automaton, NFA, for recognizing whether a string is a viable prefix of a context-free grammar or not. Now, while we discussed the construction of the automaton as an NFA, which we had to basically figure out whether a string is accepted or not by tracking all the possible states that that string could be in at any point of time, right? So we would basically track a subset of the states of an NFA at any time. Another formulation of the same algorithm is through a DFA, and one way to construct a DFA is by just taking that NFA and using a standard subset of states construction to construct a DFA. Now, notice that it is somewhat easy to figure out what the states of the DFA would be. Most of these states would, so the NFA states, if you recall, were basically items. And these items were kind of had to be related in some way for them to have transitions among them. And the DFA states would typically have groups of items such that the different items are connected through epsilon moves in the NFA. All right. So for example, if there was an item like x produces dot y, then all the items that had y produces, let's say, alpha, and y produces beta, and so on, they were in the original NFA, they were epsilon moves to these different items. In the DFA, we are going to consider this as one single state, right? This would be the epsilon closure of the first state. Right, so this would be the epsilon closure, and that would form a DFA state. So it helps to also think of this automaton as a DFA, and we're going to see some examples and actually implement this algorithm using pseudocode. It would actually help to also think about this as a DFA. Once again, there is nothing complicated about it. In an NFA, we are basically tracking some subset of states. In a DFA, we just make a state for every possible subset of states, and then we do the standard subset of states constructions for transitions as well. Okay. So with that, now we have a machine, whether it be a DFA or an NFA, an automaton that can tell us whether some string is a viable prefix or not, right? And so based on that, we can define our first LR parsing algorithm, and that's the LR0 parsing algorithm. And this is how it works. Let's say at any point in my shift reduce parsing, I am at this state where we have alpha on the stack, then there's a cursor, and then I have omega, which is the unseen input so far. Now I want to figure out whether I'm on the right path or not. So what I can do is I can run the viable prefix automaton, whether it be the DFA or the NFA, on alpha as an input. Okay, and if I basically figured out that the automaton actually returned an error, which basically means that it got stuck somewhere because there was no possible transition and I haven't yet consumed the entire alpha, then that basically means that I have a parse error, right? So I've come on a path which is not a viable prefix, and because it's not a viable prefix, I have no hope of actually reducing this state of the shift reduced parser back to the original start symbol. And so if I'm stuck, then it's a parser. Okay. What's the other option? The other option is that this particular string alpha reaches an item x produces beta dot in the NFA. Now notice that I'm talking about it as though it's an NFA. So when I say that it reaches x produces beta dot in an NFA, it basically means it can reach through some path, through some non-deterministic path, it can reach x produces beta dot when run on alpha. Now, if it can reach x produces beta dot, then that basically means that I should reduce using this production. Okay, so that's what the automaton is doing. Automaton is not only figuring out what are the viable prefixes, but it's also telling us at what step I am in my viable prefix. So if this is what it is, if this is the item which is reached after running the automaton on alpha, then I need to reduce because dot is at the very last position of the RHS, right? Which means that here there's nothing more to consume, and so the only option here is to kind of reduce beta to x. Notice that if I have reached beta, then basically I should have beta in my stack, on the top of my stack also. That's just by the construction of the automaton. Also, I would like to point out that if I'm using a DFA instead of an NFA, then I would just change this statement to saying that if the state if the DFA state contains x produces beta dot as one of the items in that state. Recall that a DFA state is a subset of NFA states. So if it contains x produces beta dot, then I'm going to reduce. Okay. Similarly, if after running the automaton on alpha, if I reach a state which looks like the following, x produces some string beta which contains terminals and non-terminals, dot t, small t, which is represents the terminal, followed by some gamma, then I should shift. Okay, and I should shift and by consuming the next token, and hopefully the next token is going to be at small t, right? If I have a look ahead, then I can also check whether the next token is a small t and only then shift. Okay, so the idea is that if I reach a state which is x produces beta dot, where dot is on the rightmost side, then I'm going to reduce. If dot is somewhere in the middle or in the beginning, then I'm going to shift. Now, the obvious question is, if it can reach both these states, then what do I do? Well, that's the case of a shift-reduce conflict. So first of all, it is possible that there are two, you reach two states. One of them is x1 produces beta 1 dot, and the other is x2 produces beta 2 dot. And both of them indicate a reduction, but they indicate different reductions. So I could either reduce beta 2 to x2 or beta 1 to x1. And which one should I do? Well, that's, it's a choice. In our shift reduce parsing state, and if we reach such a choice, then we have a reduce conflict in our parser. And in a predictive parser, we won't have any choice. We will just have to say that I don't know how to resolve this choice, or I'm going to just pick one arbitrary choice or something like that, but that's not going to be satisfactory. So any grammar which does not produce such a choice would be called a grammar that can be parsed using this particular algorithm, LR0 algorithm. So it will be called an LR0 grammar. Notice that LR0 has no look ahead. Okay. Similarly, if you reach two states, one of them is x1 produces beta 1 dot, which indicates a reduce, and the other one produces x2 produces beta 2 dot t gamma, which indicates a shift, then I have a shift reduce conflict. So I don't know whether to shift the next token and hope that it's a t, recall that there's no look ahead, or whether to reduce beta 1 to x1, and I don't really know which one to do. Okay, so the algorithm is the following, that at every point I'm going to run the entire stack from bottom to top or left to right on the automaton. If I get stuck, I'm not being able to parse this, there's a parse error. If I reach this particular state, a state that looks like x produces beta dot, then I reduce. If I reach a state that looks like x produces beta dot followed by some token t and followed by some other string gamma, then I'm going to shift. And if I have more multiple options, then I call it a conflict. All right. Okay. So this is the LR0 algorithm, LR0 parsing algorithm. We already knew what is shift-reduce parsing algorithm. We were basically saying initial exposition of the shift-reduce parsing algorithm was that some oracle is telling us whether to shift or reduce. Now here we have an automaton that's going to help us make this decision. Sometimes it's going to say shift, sometimes it's going to say reduce, sometimes it's going to say neither, which means it's a parse error, and sometimes it's going to throw up multiple options, in which case it's a conflict, right? So if it throws a conflict, then it's not an LR0 grammar. Or if it could throw a conflict on any particular string, while parsing any particular string, then it's not an LR0 grammar. So one way to improve the precision of this algorithm is to increase the look ahead, right? So maybe I start looking at the next token t, and based on that, I can rule out certain options. So for example, if I have a shift reduce conflict, so let's say I reach these two states. One is a reduced state, x produces beta dot, and the other is a shift state, x produces beta dot t gamma. But then I know I have a look ahead of one, so I can look at the next token, and the next token is, let's say, not t. If the next token is not t, then I can rule out the shift possibility, because In the shift, I would have expected the next token to be T. And that's what my NFA would have done. It would have shift, it would have consumed small T and moved to a new state. But now there is no, I mean, if there's some other not terminal, let's say T prime, then there is no, the NFA has gotten stuck, which basically means that I have reached a situation which is not a viable prefix, which means I basically reached a problem. And so the shift step would in that case lead us to a wrong path. And so the only path that is left is going to be X produces beta dot. Now you may say, okay, how do I know whether the reduced path is going to lead us to the right path or not? Either, or maybe, you know, it doesn't even solve the reduce conflict. Maybe there are two reduces or something like that. So that's the next improvement over the LR0 algorithm. So once again, we have already learned about the LR0 algorithm. That's our first LR parsing algorithm. And now we're going to learn about the next improvement over LR0 algorithm, which is the simple LR algorithm or SLR algorithm. Right? And these algorithms only differ in how precisely do they rule out moves that are not fruitful to reduce conflicts. Right? Just like we saw in the previous example, maybe with the look ahead of one, I was able to rule out more things. Right? So the more things they can rule out, the more precise they become. And just some heuristics to rule out more and more stuff makes it more and more precise. So what is the heuristic that simple LR uses to rule out some of these possibilities? So the simple LR improves the LR0 algorithm by the following idea. First of all, it uses the look ahead to see whether it should shift or not, just like we discussed in the previous slide. So if the next token is a small t and the NFA basically expects some other t, then it's, you know, then that shift is not an option. All right. Similarly, reduce by X producing beta only if the next look ahead, small t, belongs to follow of X. All right. So the first thing to note here is that SLR uses a look ahead of 1. Right? So we already said that, especially in the case of shift, it's very useful. If the next token is something other than what the NFA expects, then we can just say that shift is not an option. Now I want to also rule out some of the reduce options if possible, whenever possible. And so here's the idea that if I have an option of reducing by X produce, by this particular production, X producing beta, then I check what is my next token in my input stream. If that next token does not belong to follow of X, then I don't reduce. Okay, so what's the rationale behind doing this? Well, notice that if I have alpha, if I have this particular state here of my shift reduce parser, right? Alpha cursor t omega, then if I reduce by beta, then I'm going to end up with some state which looks like alpha prime x cursor and t omega, because I would have reduced a part of alpha which would be beta with capital X, and I would have left the cursor unchanged and the next terminal is still small t. And now, for this to be a valid parse, this needs to get reduced all the way to the start symbol, which means that this is actually a valid rightmost derivation starting from the start symbol. And if this is a valid rightmost derivation, the terminal small t follows capital X. All right. And so this reduction would only make sense if small t belongs to follow of X. And recall that we learned about how to compute follow sets when we were discussing LL1 parsing, recursive descent LL1 parsing. And so we can use the same algorithm to identify the follow sets of all non-terminals. And then we can use this pruning heuristic, which is that if my look ahead terminal does not belong to follow X, then that particular reduction is ruled out. Otherwise, that potential reduction is active and I'll have to consider it. So simple LR is an improvement over LR0 because it rules out some more reductions. And anything that rules out some more reductions or more shifts, then basically reduces the number of potential conflicts. And anything that reduces the number of potential conflicts means that it can now accept or parse more grammars. Okay, so that's why SLR is a an improvement over LRC, you know, because it can now parse more grammars. Some grammars that were not parsable using LR0 are now parsable using SLR. Now, LR1 is actually an even better improvement over SLR. And the idea here is that you build the look ahead into the item states itself. So recall that in the NFA, we were basically saying that each state is the item, which basically represents what kind of prefix I have already seen in my stack, all right? But now I also say that what kind of prefix I have seen on my stack and what is my look ahead token for one look ahead. So I'm just going to say, this is a stream that I've seen on the stack and this is my next look ahead token. And now if I consume a token, where do I go and so on. So in this particular scheme, my items now look like a tuple. One is the original LR items, which I'm now also now going to call LR0 items, which is just the production, the dot plays anywhere. But now it also has another component, which is any terminal derived from the terminal set of the language. So any token in the grammar. Now LR1, so notice that LR1 is strictly more powerful than LR0 because the items now are more fine grained. Now for a single item in LR0, I have n items in LR1, one for each token. And so I have more fine grained disambiguation of what state I am in. And based on that more fine grained disambiguation, I can make better decisions. Or in other words, I'll have fewer conflicts. However, one of the problems with this LR1 strategy is that the NFA can become really large because the number of tokens can be pretty large for a large language and large grammar. And so one of the kind of simplifications over LR1 is LALR1, which LR1 tracks the look-ahead token in a fine-grained manner by incorporating it into the NFA states. And LALR1 is an improvement, or is, I should say, a simplification over LR1. And it's a simplification in the sense that it reduces the size of the NFA, but it is not an improvement. There's a trade-off because it also now accepts fewer grammars. It's able to parse fewer grammars, as we saw in the Venn diagram in the previous module. And so in LALR1 mod automaton, how does it simplify? It merges two states in the NFA if they differ only in the look-ahead token. So in the NFA, if the two states differ only in the look-ahead token and nothing else, which means, you know, all the outgoing edges are identical, all the outgoing transitions are identical, or the incoming transitions are identical, the only difference is basically in the look-ahead token contained in that particular NFA state, then you just merge all of them together. And doing this, basically you lose some precision, but importantly, you shrink the size of your NFA or the DFA significantly, and that's a significant improvement. And so most languages are actually LALR1, and as I've said before, popular parser generator tools like Python use LALR1 by default.